Thank you for your people, your servants, our ministers, brothers and sisters. We're asking, Lord, that tonight you enrich every life in Jesus' name. And your purpose of bringing us here, you will fulfill abundantly for every life in Jesus' name. Bless everyone without exception. Show us what we need to know. And let your grace, your power, your strength energize everyone for the ministry ahead in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Tonight we are coming to John chapter 15. I will read him from verse 8. John 15, reading from verse 8. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. The Lord is telling us something very important, showing us what we need to do and who we need to be. He says, if we're going to be his disciples, we must bear fruit. Bear more fruit, bear much fruit, and then the Father will be glorified. If the Father will be glorified, and God will be happy, and the Lord Jesus Christ will also be happy, his desires being fulfilled. Only when disciples bear fruit, how about preachers? How about pastors? How about ministers? How about workers in the kingdom of God? The Lord is glorified, and the ministry is exalted. Sinners are saved, and many people come into the kingdom when we bear fruit, bear more fruit, and bear much fruit. In verse 16, it tells us the reason why he chose us, and the reason why he appointed us, and the reason why he chose you in particular, and appointed you in particular. Always understand that. Why am I a minister? Why am I a pastor? Why am I a preacher? Why am I a chosen person in the hands of the Lord? It says, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. Stop there for a moment. You cannot say, I chose it, and so I can give it up. You cannot say, because I took it up myself, I can give it up anytime I want. The Lord says no, that you have not chosen him, and you have not chosen the ministry, but he himself has chosen you. Think about Moses. It wasn't Moses that chose his ministry to the children of Israel, and so he couldn't give up and say, I'm no more doing it. It wasn't Aaron that chose himself to be the high priest in the land of Israel. The Lord chose him. And then it says, when you think about Joshua, it says, my servant Moses is dead. Rise up now, go before the people and divide the land before them. Joshua did not choose the Lord, but the Lord chose Joshua. I have found my servant David, in whom he has a heart to fulfill my will. The Lord chose him. And when you think about Paul the apostle, it was the Lord that chose him. And then the same thing with you, the same thing with me, the same thing with every one of us. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. And so you cannot toss the ministry off and give it up. I'm tired, I'm weak, I don't know what the people are doing, and I'm not seeing the much fruit I want to see. Maybe I should have a substitute, an alternative. You have not chosen him. He has chosen you and ordained you that he should go and bring forth fruit. That's the purpose. That's the plan. That's the reason why the Lord has chosen each of us. And it says that your fruit may remain, shall remain, and that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. In the process of working for the Lord, in the process of ministering, in the process of fulfilling the call and the choice the Lord has given you, you will come across challenges that will require prayer. You'll come across needs and counseling that will require prayer. You'll come across people in the ministry, in the church, that will request for your prayers. In your personal life, there'll be times you will need to pray, and the Lord gives the assurance once you are set by Him. And you accept His offer, and you accept what He has called you to do, and you know you cannot give up the ministry, toss away the ministry anytime you want, and you are there, you are abiding in that work, in the ministry, in the place He has chosen for you and placed you. Whatsoever you will ask as a minister, as a preacher, as a pastor, as a personal individual believer, whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father, He will give it to you. He will answer your prayers in Jesus' name. Today we're talking on the, we're speaking on the topic, advancing towards higher productive leadership. Advancing towards higher productive leadership. That means as a leader, you are not stagnant. As a leader, you are not in one place all the time. As a leader, you are making progress. You are advancing. And you are moving from one level to a higher level. How will that happen? How can we do that? 3 points we are looking at. Number one, anointing of the Spirit for purified leaders. The anointing of the Spirit of God for purified leaders. Number two, advancing in His service, advancing in the work of the Lord with purposeful leaders. We have to have purpose. You have to have purpose in your heart, and purpose in developing program, having the process, and going through the strategies, everything you need to do, everything you ought to do. You have to look at your community, and you have to look at the people, the sinners and the saints, the members of the church, and also our non-church members, and to develop program for them. You want to advance, and you want to bring believers into the church. You want to develop members of the church. There'll be a purpose of heart, advancing in His service with purposeful leaders. Number three, abiding in the stewardship for productive leadership. Abiding in the stewardship. If you are off and on, in and out, working and not working, busy and idle, and you are not abiding in stewardship, abiding with a steadfast heart, abiding with a purposeful heart, abiding with programs and process, and the need to actually be available every time, ministering to the people, there's not going to be any advancement, and there's not going to be any growth, but you're abiding in the stewardship for productive leadership. Let's come to number one. Number one, anointing of the Spirit for purified leaders. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 1 verses 21 and 22. Anointing. We need anointing. We need the power of the Spirit. We need unction, and we need endowment of power, the Spirit of God enveloping us, energizing us from the inner man, and showing us where we ought to go and what we ought to do. And when we get to that point of ministry and that point of service, to give us the necessary power to carry out the scene, the ministry He has called us to effectively fulfill over there. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, reading from verse 21, now He which establishes us with you in Christ and has anointed us is God. He establishes us, apostles, with you, the ministers and the members. And He has anointed us, apostles and ministers and pastors and evangelists and teachers, everyone, with you, the ministers, soul winners and the members. He who has done that, giving us that anointing, is God Himself. Look at verse 22. In verse 22, who has also sealed us. He establishes us, He anoints us, He empowers us. He seals us with the seal of protection and the seal of preservation. And He has given us the earnest. He has given us the first deposit. And He has given us the initial power of the Spirit in our hearts. And that is how God anoints us. You're saved, you're sanctified, and now He anoints you with power. Let's look at three things here. Number one, anointing after purifying sanctification. A kind of sanctification that is not a notion in the head. A kind of sanctification that brings purity of heart. And after that purifying sanctification, you have the anointing of the Holy Ghost. You have the endowment of power. Number two, assurance through promise sanctification. He has given the promise. And because He has given the promise and He is a faithful God, what He has promised, He will always remember. Not only that, He's a mighty, powerful God. What He is able to do, is willing to do. And He has the power to carry out His own promise. And because of that, we have the assurance after we're saved. And then we go to the Lord with consecration and with commitment. And we yield ourselves from the inner man to the spirit, the body, every part of us that is bought by the price of the blood of Jesus. We say, I belong to You. I'm bought with a price. Everything in me, every skill I have, every talent I have is Yours, because You have purchased me with that great precious price, and I laid that upon the altar. And then with faith we pray that it will purify, it will circumcise the heart, it will sanctify us. He'll do it. We have assurance through the promised sanctification, and then with the anointing and the prayer of assurance, we have authority of prayerful saints. The authority of prayerful saints. After we're saved, we don't stop praying. After we're sanctified, we don't stop praying. After we're filled with the Holy Ghost, we don't stop praying. We keep on praying. And we have the assurance that when we stand on the promises of God, those promises are going to be fulfilled. And we have authority thereby, because we are importunate in prayer. Because we are faithful in prayer. Because we are diligent in prayer. Because we always hold on to the promise of God in prayer. Let's look at number one there. That's the anointing after purifying sanctification. Understand that word, sanctification. Understand the qualifying word, purifying. Anybody that says, I have sanctification, I experience sanctification, I possess sanctification, there must be that qualifying word, purifying sanctification. That sanctification purifies us. That sanctification purges us. And if we really have the experience, there's purity of heart, purity of life, purity of language, purity of intention, purity of motive, everything within, everything around is purified. Look at Acts chapter 15, verse 9. Acts chapter 15, verse 9. And He put no difference between us and them. Here Peter was talking about the house of Cornelius, and they were Gentiles. He put no difference between us, Jews, and the Gentiles, house of Cornelius, purifying their hearts by faith. Purifying their hearts by faith. Now you understand that in the house of Cornelius, as Peter was declaring the word and preaching the word, there wasn't a separate time. Okay, now get saved and let's settle that. That's all right. Now you must get consecrated now. Let's settle that. Get sanctified. And then you must settle this. You must have the Holy Ghost baptism. In God's own sovereign way, He gave them those experiences. Their hearts were open. and they were ready, and they wanted everything the Lord had for them. And they told Peter, here we are, we're all here to receive, to have, to possess everything you have for us. And then the Lord saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost. And the revelation of Peter tells us that he purified their hearts by faith. On their own part, they had faith in God. And because of that faith in God, they might not know at that time the death and the ways of that sanctification experience, but they had the purifying of their hearts by faith in God. It was after that now the Holy Ghost baptism and the anointing of the Spirit came on them. Acts chapter 11. In Acts chapter 11 verse 15, it tells us, and as I began to speak, the Holy Ghost fell on them as on us at the beginning. You understand what Peter is saying here? He's saying the sanctification we had is what they had, and the Holy Ghost baptism we had is what they had. No difference at all. He says, as I was speaking to them, as I was declaring the truth to them, that Christ is our Savior, and that all the prophets of the Old Testament, they bear witness to this fact, that Jesus Christ is the one that was sent to give us remission, forgiveness, redemption from sin. As I was speaking to them, telling them about the place of Christ, the position of Christ, the power of Christ, and all that the Father in heaven had ordained that Jesus Christ would be, of just talking to them like that, we had not even started praying for the message to end, the Holy Ghost fell on them as on us at the beginning. And then it says in verse 16, then remembered I the word of the Lord, how he had said, John indeed baptized with water, John immersed in water, and John enveloped them in water, and John dipped them in water, so that the water was all over them and all around them. In the same way as John immersed the people in water, they'll be immersed in the Holy Ghost. They'll be saturated with the Holy Ghost, and they will be endued with the Holy Ghost all around them, all over them, and all within them. And John indeed baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized of the Holy Ghost. And then verse 17, it says in verse 17, for as much then as God gave them the like gift as he did unto us, our Gentiles, the Lord gave them the same, the like gift as he gave to us, they shall receive power. The Lord gave them the same power as he gave to us. When that Holy Ghost comes, it will lead you into all truth. The Lord gave them that teacher, the Holy Ghost, as he gave unto us. The Lord gave them the one that will reveal the might of Christ and reveal the future. He gave them the whole package as he gave unto us at the beginning. Who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I that I could withstand God? He was saying, they were not even baptized in water yet, but he was saved, he was sanctified, and were filled with the Holy Ghost. And if the Lord did that for the Jews and for the Gentiles, as he did for them, the promise is unto you and to your children, and to many that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. If ye then being able know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father who is in heaven give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? That's why we're commanded, be filled with the Holy Ghost and not be drunk with wine. Be being filled, you were filled before, be filled again, be saturated again, be empowered again, be endued again with the Holy Ghost. It will do it in every life in Jesus' name. Look at number two now. Number two, assurance through the promise, sanctification. Salvation has been promised, we can come, he'll give to us. Sanctification has been promised, we can come, he'll give to us purity of heart and purity of life, that he purifies us as any man that ever lived could ever be pure. How pure was Enoch? He can do that for you. How pure was Joseph? He can do that for you. How pure was Moses? He can do that for you. How pure was Paul the apostle? He can do that for you. How Paul were the disciples and the followers of the Lord Jesus Christ when he prayed to the Father and he says, sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. And he said, I pray not for these alone, but for all them that shall believe on my name through their word. How pure were they? You can be as pure as that. Your heart can be pure. Your mind can be pure. Your language can be pure. Your disposition can be pure. And your intention, your desires can be pure. You can be pure within and without. Because this is the promise of God. And this is what he said he will do. He will do it in every life. Look at Leviticus chapter 20, verses 7 and 8. Leviticus chapter 20, verse 7. Sanctify yourself. Therefore, you must understand as students of the word that that word sanctify has actually two sides to it. One side is being set apart. The other side is being made holy. As you look at any good dictionary, it will tell you, you have the word sanctify, set apart. You have the word sanctify, that same word, made holy. And on the human side, you are the one to set yourself apart. The Lord's hand is upon you. Before you were born, I knew you and I ordained you, Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5, to be a prophet unto the nations. He set you apart and you come in agreement with the Lord and you sanctify yourself, you set yourself apart, you say the will of God is what I want to do, the word of God is what I want to be, the path of righteousness is what I want to follow, everything the Lord ordains for me is what I want to do. Set yourself apart. Sanctify yourselves therefore and be ye holy. If there are things you need to take off from your life, some bad habits you need to turn away from, and some things you have been used to in your life that will not make you a real standing new creature, New Testament believer, by yourself, those things you can get rid of, you get rid of them, you throw them away from your life. Be ye holy, for I am the Lord your God. And the Lord your God means you are born again already. It means you are saved already. And now in verse 8 it says, and ye shall keep my statutes and do them. You cannot do that without being born again. You are saved, and when you are saved, you are made free from sin and you become a servant of righteousness. Being then made free from sin, we become the servants of righteousness and we bring the fruit of holiness unto God. And because of that, ye shall keep my statutes and do them. I am the Lord which sanctify you. But it says, sanctify yourselves. That's the first meaning of sanctification. Now, I am the Lord that sanctify you. He is the one that does the internal work, the experiential work. And the second work of grace, he effects that in your life. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 30 verse 6, the same thing, but now he uses another language, another word for that sanctification. And the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart. The children of Israel had their body already sanctified. Flesh circumcision. But now the heart. What does that mean? In the fleshless circumcision, the tissue they brought into the world, which should not be part of their life, that will just be collecting bacteria. All that is cut away. That is the fleshly circumcision. And the same thing now in the heart. The heart were brought into the world with Adamic nature, with depravity, and that will just be collecting defilement and collecting things that are not right, iniquity before the Lord. The Lord says, you cannot do this one. You cannot reach into your heart and circumcise your heart and sanctify your heart and purify your heart and cleanse your heart and so purge your heart that it will be a heart that will please God every time. And the Lord says, but I'll do that for you. That's why it says, and the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart. He will, as you come to him. He must, as you come to him. It is a promise that cannot fail. And we have the assurance that as you come to the Lord and say, thank you, Lord, because I'm saved. Thank you, Lord, because I'm forgiven. Thank you, Lord, because I'm a new creature in Christ. I come now for what you have promised. You said you'll sanctify me, and you said you'll purify me. You said you'll take that Adamic nature I brought into the world. You said you'll take it away, Lord. I come to you now. Circumcise my heart. And it is to love thy God. When that sanctification takes place, when that circumcision of heart takes place, it will make you to love the Lord thy God with all thine heart. You'll not be part here and part there. Your love will be pure. Your love will be full. Your love will be transparent. Your love will be persevering. Your love will be permanent for God. And that's the first commandment according to the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. The great and the first commandment is this, that you love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. And that is only possible. And God requires that. And God is not finished with you until that is done. And he does that on the basis of this second work of grace, that he now circumcises you to love your God with all your heart and with all your soul, that thou mayest live. That's real life. That's real life. Spiritual life, abundant life, a fulfilling life, and a fulfilled life, that thou mayest live. Look at number three here. Number three is authority of praying saints. The authority of praying saints. As I said before, at the point of salvation, we pray. After salvation, we keep on praying. Any temptation coming, any trial coming, we pray. Whatever may be going on, whatever may be happening, we're happy, we keep praying. We're sad, we keep on praying. We're well, we're healthy, we're sound, we're giving thanks to God, we're praying. We're sick or we're weak, we're praying. We pray without ceasing. Every day there'll be a reason to pray, a need to praise God, a need to exalt the name of the Lord. If you are a believer, if you are a Christian, prayer must be the obvious thing of your life, must be the characteristic that is well known in your life. And now it tells us the authority we have when we pray. Saved, you're praying. Sanctified, you keep on praying. Filled with the Holy Ghost, you keep on praying. A member, you keep on praying. You become a minister, your praying comes up and goes up, and then you have a new level, higher level of responsibility in the kingdom, in the ministry, in the church. And as you are growing in opportunities, your prayerfulness is also increasing and growing. That is the normal process and the normal growth we ought to have, and that gives us authority. We're told in Acts chapter 1, reading from verse 4. Acts chapter 1, reading from verse 4, and being assembled together with them, commanded them, that's talking about Christ, That's talking about the Savior. That's talking about the Commander-in-Chief. That's talking about the one we've given our hearts to. And then he decides everything that happens in our lives, every move in our lives, every direction of our life, every decision of our life, where we stay, where we go, where we refuse to go. He decides everything, and he doesn't give us the liberty to take our lives into our hands and say, tomorrow I will do this, next tomorrow I will do that. We have abandoned our hearts unto him, and he's the controller, he's the commander in our lives. He has bought us with a price, and we become his bond slave. He's the one now that commanded them and said they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father. He prayed for their sanctification after salvation. After sanctification, now you wait and pray and tarry for the promise of the Father, which says he, ye have heard of me. Because in verse 8, it tells us in verse 8, but he shall receive power. That's why he wanted them to wait. That's why he wants you to tarry. You get back home, we don't have enough time during the service to pray, but you get back home, and while the message is still fresh, and while the revelation is still fresh, and while the desire to follow after the Lord is still fresh, you wait upon the Lord, because he shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. The power come, ye shall be witnesses unto me. You must be saved, then ye shall be witnesses unto me. You must be sanctified, then you shall be witnesses unto me. You must be filled, saturated, enveloped, empowered with the Spirit of God, baptized in the Holy Ghost, and power ought to be in your life. And then you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, when you have the tendency to run away because they crucified our Lord, where those Pharisees are, where those Sadducees are, where the people that do not want to hear the gospel, and he said, let his blood be upon us and our children, where those rigid religionists and traditional people are in Jerusalem, let the power come, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea, in all those surroundings where you have syncretic religion. They are half a breed of people, half Jewish and half a Gentile, and in Samaria, and then unto the uttermost part of the earth. Even where it appears civilization has not reached, let the power come, and then you will have the assurance. And as you pray, you pray and preach, you pray and counsel, you pray and minister, you pray and do whatever you are going to do in the Lord and for the Lord. And everything you do for the Lord, from the preaching to the counseling to the praying for people and everything, everything is saturated with prayer, there will be authority in your life in Jesus' name. We're coming to point number two now. Point number two is advancing in his service with purposeful leaders. Advancing in his service with purposeful leaders. You want to know, my brother, my sister, nothing of note is done in this world without a purpose of heart. If you don't have any purpose in your heart, every little wind that blows will make you to change. Every little difficulty, every little trial, every little pebble on the road, every little thorn that pinches you or hurts you will make you to change. The weather will make you to change. It's too hot, everybody is sweating, it's too cold, it is raining, and the climate politically will make you to change. The kind, the nature of the place where you are, where you are ministering, you are hearing some bad news, and you are not listening to news from heaven, you are only listening to news from earth. Every little sin that goes beyond the normal and becomes a little kind of aberration or abnormal will make you to change, because there is no purpose of heart. That's why we're told, and Daniel purposed in his heart. Here we are in Babylon. It's a different place. It's a defiling place. And here, all that we have learned from home before we came to Babylon, everything will go into the drain. Will not be able to do anything here, take any stand here, and live for the glory of God here if we don't have a purpose of heart. And Daniel purposed in his heart. Everything you learn at a Bible study, you learn leadership development session, everything you learn in the workers' meeting, everything you learn in your personal devotional time, you will not carry anything out without a purpose of heart. To understand that's my destination, and to understand that's the direction I'm going, to understand this is what God had called me to do, and it will be done. There may be support, there may be opposition, there may be persecution, there may be difficulties, there may be challenges. You need a purpose of heart. And I pray God will do that for every one of us in Jesus' name. And let's look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, and we're looking at verse 10. 2 Timothy chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 10. It says, "But thou hast fully known my doctrine." Here is Paul the apostle. He was talking to Timothy, and he was trying to raise up Timothy, embolden Timothy. He was trying to challenge Timothy. You are young, and it appears you have a timid nature, a fearful nature, and if you are going to do anything and work consistently and profitably and productively in the kingdom of God, look at the qualities God has raised up in me, and then I want that to be reproduced in you. "But thou hast known my doctrine and manner of life and purpose." And purpose, and faith, and long suffering, and charity, and patience. Look at the purpose in the middle there. Without purpose, you'll not be able to maintain doctrine. As long as you have, as soon as you have questions and criticism, and then the people, religious and irreligious, speak against you without purpose of heart, you cannot stand by doctrine. Manner of life. Your manner of life, you decide that in the prayer room. You decide that as you read the word of God, you take the pattern of life, the manner of life, out of what you read, out of the word of God. Here is what God wants me to be. Here is the way God wants me to live. And you ought to be a champion in your community, a hero in your community, an unbending, consecrated, courageous conqueror in your neighborhood. But without purpose of heart, that manner of life is not possible. Faith, as you think about all the things you are ought to pray for, you've read the promises of God and you believe, "I believe God, it shall be even as it was told me." Without purpose of heart to abide and to remain where that challenge is, where that problem is, without purpose, faith is impossible. And long suffering, how can you have long suffering once there is a little pressure, a little challenge, a little difficulty? Without purpose of heart, here is where God has sent me, and I will abide in that place where God has sent me. And it doesn't matter the suffering coming from any direction, I will still long, abide long, have long suffering. Purpose of heart is necessary. Charity, that's love. You try to do good to people, and you do charity, you do all the good you can, at all the times you can, in all the places you can, by all the means you can, and as long as ever as you can, and you make up your mind, I will do good, I will help everybody, anyone in need that calls for my attention, that needs my skill, that needs my availability, I'm available. But you know, without purpose of heart, when you help people and then they return it with, you know, something unpleasant, and you try to lift up people, the people you are trying to lift up, they're trying to pull you down. Without purpose of heart, that will not be possible. And patience, can you have patience with people, patience with a problem, and patience in the peculiarities of your life? Without purpose of heart, the point is this: if we're going to advance in the service of the Lord, we need purposeful leadership. Three things we're looking at. Number one, advancing through addition. Advancing through addition. Number two, advantage over adversaries. We must always find out, how can I have advantage over adversaries? There are many adversaries, there are many challenges. How can I still keep myself on top of the boiling water, on top of the raging sea? Advantage over adversaries. Number three, admonition from our advocate. Our advocate is the Lord Jesus Christ. He has given us admonition. Number one, advancing through addition. How can you advance? How can you be better today than you were yesterday? The solution, the answer is addition. How can you be better this new year, beyond what you were in the previous years? The answer is addition. What does that mean? 2 Peter chapter 1, we're reading from verse 3. In 2 Peter chapter 1, reading from verse 3, according as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life. Stop there for a moment. He has given us all things, but facing the fact, looking at practical details and issues of our lives, we're not enjoying the all things. Why? Because we're not praying to possess the all things. We're not enjoying, we're not experiencing, we're not seeing the all things. Why? Because we hear and then we move away. We hear and we forget. We hear, we don't take it to the Lord in prayer. We hear, this is the way to go, walk ye in it, and we know that's the right thing to do, but we are superficial. But if we're going to enjoy everything he has provided, the time comes in our lives and we say, time is going, I spent a long time and I've not got everything that had been given unto me, and we say, I will not let you go like Jacob until you bless me, and we take all those things that the Lord has given one by one and claim that and stand on that, and then go out to see what we have and to see the good of what we have. He has given unto us already, he says, according as his divine power. And he says, he has given all things that pertain to life and that pertain to godliness through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and to virtue. And then in verse 4, it says in verse 4, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these promises ye might be partakers of the divine nature. Partakers of the divine nature. Do I understand what I read? Do I know the height and the depths and the ramifications of the promise the Lord is given? Do I know the intention of the Lord in promising what he has promised? The divine nature is the very nature of God. Any animal having the nature of the lion will be as bold as a lion. Any animal having the nature of an eagle will fly and will have the vision and the foresight and the far sight of an eagle. Anyone that has the nature of the fish will be able to swim in any river. Now come back. He has given unto us the divine nature. If we had the nature of God, if we went to prayer and claimed the promise of God that he gives us to become possessors, partakers of the divine nature, guess what we can be and guess what we can do in any place, in any situation, by the call of the ministry, understanding not just theoretically, as an experience. As salvation is a definite experience, as sanctification is a definite experience, as the power baptism in the Holy Ghost is a definite experience. If you went to the Lord, if I went to the Lord and I said, Lord, and you said, Lord, this is what you have promised, that you will grant us to be partakers of the divine nature. Coming out of that prayer closet, you'll be different. You're going to be different in Jesus' name. Having escaped the corruption that is in the world through laws. It will not matter any part of the world you are ministering. You escape the corruption, the defilement, the iniquity, this transgression, and the peculiar evil in that community. It makes you to escape the corruption that is in the world through laws. Look at verse 5 now. Advancing through addition. The foundation has been set. Salvation is definite. Sanctification is definite. Power of the Holy Ghost is definite. It's granted you to be a partaker of the divine nature. And besides this, giving all diligence, add. That's how we advance. Add. That's how we advance. Add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge. Verse 6, it says, and to knowledge temperance. It says you keep on adding, keep on adding, keep on adding. Because if you ever start and you hang your right hand with a cord from your neck, and you hang that hand there, by the time you bring that hand out after 1 year, you cannot use the hand again. What you don't use, you lose. And what you don't add, by itself, by natural law, will be vanishing away. You're becoming less and less and less. But if you're going to advance, and you're going to remain advancing, you're going to continue advancing, your add to knowledge temperance, and your add to temperance patience. You do it deliberately, and to patience godliness. And then in verse 7, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. Look at verse 8 now. It says, if these things be in you and abound, because you are adding and adding and adding, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's look at number 2. Number 2, advantage over the adversaries. Advantage over the adversaries. There are people that walk in the world without remembering that Satan is the god of this world. There are people who minister in the world and they seem to have this erroneous idea that the world is a bed of roses, that all you are going to find in the world will be something comfortable, something nice, something pleasant. There's no danger, there's no difficulty, there's no challenge anywhere in the world. But we need to remember that the world is under the control of the evil one. Yet, after understanding there are adversaries in the world, we need to know where we stand at advantage. Advantage over the adversaries. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, we're reading from verse 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 9. For a great door and effectual is opened unto me, and there are many adversaries. Many adversaries. Many adversaries. But understand the advantage. The door has been opened from heaven. Those adversaries are here on earth, and there's no power on earth that can effectively stop any sin that had been originated, orchestrated, and given from heaven. That's the advantage, that the one on high and the most high and the God of heaven and Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who has conquered the devil, who has conquered death, who has conquered disease, who has conquered demons, who has conquered every power that may be on earth, he is the one in heaven who has opened the door. Not only that, a great door, a great door of opportunity, a great door of ministry. And God has done that for a purpose. Although there are many adversaries here on earth, but all those adversaries here on earth, think about it like this, they are like reptiles. They are walking on the earth, and then they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will mount up with wings as eagles, like you are like a flying eagle, and the reptiles on the ground, they cannot fly, they cannot get to the height you have gone to. You have an advantage. Spiritual, they are earthly. You're spiritual, they are fleshly. And you have the power of God, the power that created the whole universe, and they cannot create anything. Our advantage is that it is the God of heaven who has opened the door for us. And then Paul the apostle said, unto me, he said, look at this. Although really I'm the least of the saints and the least of the apostles, not qualified to be an apostle, and yet a door opened to me that was not opened unto Peter, not opened unto John, not opened unto the initial disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. What an advantage. We have this great advantage. And the Lord makes you to see more of your advantages rather than your adversaries in Jesus' name. Did I hear an amen? Amen. Luke chapter 21, verse 15. In Luke chapter 21, reading from verse 15, here is the Lord Jesus Christ talking to his own disciples. And I will give you a mouth and wisdom which all your adversaries put together shall not be able to gainsay nor resist. I will give you a mouth that will not be closed when you ought to talk, a mouth that will not be trembling when you ought to speak courageously, a mouth associated with a heart that is having the revelation of heaven. I will give you a mouth, and I'll give you wisdom, which all your adversaries, no matter their background, and no matter their learning, and no matter the occultic power or any other kind of power they have, that all your adversaries shall not be able to give, say, oppose, or resist. Look at Philippians chapter 1, we're reading from verse 27. Philippians chapter 1, reading from verse 27. Only let your conversation be as it becomes the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs. Look at this, that ye stand fast in one spirit, energized in your spirit, empowered in your spirit, stabilized, solid, steadfast in your spirit, and with one mind striving for the together for the faith of the gospel. In verse 28, in verse 28 it says, and in nothing be terrified by your adversaries. In nothing be terrified by your adversaries. Look beyond those adversaries and look at the Lord himself, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the one who called you and the one who raised you up and the one who says, I set a great door before you. And all those adversaries, they will not be able to gainsay or resist or oppose or overpower you. Look beyond those adversaries and in nothing be terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of perdition, but to you of salvation and of God. Of salvation and of God. The Lord will stand by you. Amen. And the Lord will stay by you. Amen. You will always have advantage over all the adversaries in Jesus' name. Amen. Look at number three now. Number three, admonition from our advocate. Admonition from our advocate. It tells us in Matthew chapter 24, verse 12. Matthew chapter 24, verse 12. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Because iniquity shall abound. There are times in the community in which we live, maybe you've been living there now for more than 5 years, 10 years, and then iniquity, violence, terrible things are happening that didn't happen 7, 8, 10 years ago. Iniquity abounding. Because of that, there are some people, they give up, they collapse, they fold up, their love will wax cold. It may be in the state where you are, where you're ministering, maybe in the local government. You've been there now for some time. It was peaceful there before, and people had some level of morality, and they knew that you can't do this, you can't do that, and the society over there was kind of convenient, and it gave itself, it lent itself to ministering the gospel. But now things are changing over there, and because violence will be on the increase, iniquity on the increase, abounding, the love of many shall wax cold. It may be in the office where you are working, there's a level of predictability. That is, you could predict what will happen, what could not happen. But nowadays, everything is unpredictable because iniquity is abounding in that office. Because of that, some people don't have any stand anymore. They cannot stand on anything. They flow with the tide and they go with the world. The love of many shall wax cold, but not everybody will wax cold. You will not wax cold. I will not wax cold. Look at verse 13. Then it says, but he that shall endure. There's somebody that will single himself out. There's a lady, a sister, that will single herself out. Yes, I know what prevails. I know what other people are doing. I know the concept. I know the understanding of other people. I know their utterances. You cannot stand here now. It's not like 30 years ago, and it's not like 40 years ago. Iniquity is abounding now, and the love of many waxing cold. Everybody is giving up, but there is a determined person, a purposeful heart, a purposeful leader that will not give up, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. Who is that person? You will stand. I said you will stand. There is grace enough. There is power enough. There's the divine nature, the nature of the Lion of the tribe of Judah. You will stand in Jesus' name. Revelation chapter 2 verse 26. In Revelation chapter 2, reading from verse 26. He that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end. He that overcometh and keepeth my works, the work of evangelism, the work of discipling, the work of going out and reaching out, bringing them in, compel them to come in, and the work of making them stable and steadfast in the doctrine of the word of God, and in the breaking of bread, and in prayers, being steadfast unto the end. He that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. Chapter 3 verse 11. In chapter 3 verse 11 of Revelation, behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast. We can be steadfast. Hold that fast. We can be focused. We can be single-minded. Hold that fast. If it were not possible, the Lord will not have told us to do it. Hold that fast, what you have, that which you have, that no man take thy crown. No man will take your crown in Jesus' name. Point number 3 now, abiding in the stewardship for productive leadership. Abiding in the stewardship for productive leadership. Look at John chapter 15. I'm reading from verse 4. Abide. Abide in me, and I in you. Abide in me. Close yourself with me. Abide in me, so that my revelation is your revelation. My inspiration is your inspiration. My focus is your focus. My progress is your progress. The path I tread is the path you tread. What I would have done if I were there at this time, that is what you're doing. Abide in me, and I in you. My courage in you, my vision in you, my determination in you, my purpose of heart in you, my perseverance in you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. Look at verse 7. In verse 7, if ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and shall be done unto you. 3 things we're looking at. Number 1, recognizing our assigned stewardship. Number 2, refusing all appealing substitutes. Number 3, rewarding approved single-mindedness. Number 1, recognizing our assigned stewardship. In Mark chapter 13, verse 34. Mark chapter 13, verse 34. For the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house, and he gave authority to his servants, look at this, and to every man his work, and to every man his work, and commanded the porter to watch. Look at the Lord Jesus Christ himself, the Son of Man, taking a far journey. His stewardship had been assigned from the foundation of the world. That's why it's referred to as the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If you remember, I will bring enmity, give enmity between you and the woman, between her seed and your seed. He will bruise your heel, your head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. That's the assignment of the Lord Jesus Christ that had been given. He recognized that, and he said, I don't you know I must be about my Father's business? You remember Jeremiah? Before you were born, I ordained you, I assigned you, I pre-wrote you, I wrote it down, that you will be a prophet unto the nations. You remember John the Baptist? His name shall be called John. He'll be filled with the Holy Ghost from his mother's womb. He will turn the hearts of the children unto the fathers. He'll prepare the way of the Lord. Remember Paul the Apostle, that he who brought me out of my mother's womb, he is the one who has called me and has shown me what to do. He recognized that. He gave authority to the servants and to every man his work. He has given you the work to do. Recognize that, abide in that, and stay in that. Look at number two there. Number two, refusing all appealing substitutes. There will be substitutes. There will be things that will come to you and say, doesn't this appeal to you? This is substitute. This is an alternative. Couldn't you do this? Look at Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, reading from verse 24. By faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. That was an appealing substitute. Is it better for you to stay in the palace and to be the son of the emperor through Pharaoh's daughter, and to rule over the nation of Egypt, the greatest power at that time in the whole earth? But he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Verse 25, this was the choice chosen, rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Why? Because in verse 26, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect, he had great evaluation, he put a great value unto the recompense of the reward. And I pray that same heart, that same mind that will refuse all appealing substitutes, God will grant to everyone in Jesus' name. Look at John chapter 6, verse 15. John chapter 6, verse 15. When Jesus therefore perceived that they would come and make him, take him by force and make him a king, he departed again into a mountain himself alone. Why? He was to be a king over Israel, one nation. He was to be a king, a political title over the people of Israel, because they expected he will deliver them from the Roman power. But he was looking at the cross, and he preferred the cross to the earthly crown. And it was an appealing substitute that he will be a king over them. But no, he'll be the Lamb of God that takes the sin of the whole world away. That is, he will be the Savior of the world, the Savior of sinners at that time, and the Savior of sinners every time in every generation until he will come again. And then his time will come. He'll be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, refusing all appealing substitutes in your life, in your ministry. There may be a pulling away. Somebody wants to draw you away, and he wants to give you an appealing substitute. But as you look at the calling of God, at the ministry he has called you to, all those things will not appeal to you. You will stand in the way, in the word, in the will of God, in Jesus' name. Number three now, rewarding approved single-mindedness. Rewarding approved single-mindedness. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 50 verse 7. Isaiah chapter 50 verse 7. For the Lord God will help me, that God will help you. Therefore shall I not be confounded. You will not be confounded. You will not be ashamed. You will not be shaken out of the place the Lord has put you in, Jesus' name. Therefore have I set my face like a flint, and I know I shall not be ashamed. I set my face as a flint. I know my destination. I know my calling. I know the ministry that he has called me to. And whatever wind is blowing, whatever waves of the sea may be running, I set my face as a flint. You will not turn back. You will not slow down. You will not give up. You will not turn to the right or to the left. You will focus on where the Lord has appointed for you, in Jesus' name. And this work of the Lord will prosper in your hand. All the privileges he opens before you, all the great doors he opens before you, whatever adversaries and whatever challenges, you set your face as a flint, and you'll keep on ministering and keep on doing the work of God, and he will reward your work even in this life and on the final day, in Jesus' name. As I said before, we don't have enough time here to pray now. But when you go back home, take everything we've heard today, everything we've learned today, take it back to the Lord in prayer. You will make progress in Jesus' name. You will advance in Jesus' name. Higher you will go. Farther you will go. Greater things you will do. And everything that has not been done, that the Lord had assigned, appointed for you to do, you will do in Jesus' name. Nobody else will take your place. All the power you need, all the anointing, all the unction you need, the Lord will grant unto you in Jesus' name. Give me a leadership. Amen. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer while we call on Pastor Hassan from FCT to lead us in prayer. The Lord in prayer while we call on